deals with quite a few requests during the year for parades and road races. He devotes sometimes quite a bit of time, particularly to those folks that aggressively request a road race on Shore Road. Usually those permits are not granted, but it is an issue that is dealt with. Along with that, you know, we do have to review the liability coverage, and oftentimes we do provide, if the police aren't busy, they do get involved with some gratis assistance, so we feel the $25 permit is reasonable. Police accident report, $5 to $7. This is recommended as part of the, earlier in the budget process. Plea complaint reports from 5 to 7. Photograph copies from 5 to 10. The zoning board application fee from 45 to 75. There's been a tremendous increase in the cost of postage, the cost of photocopying, and the cost of legal advertisements. And that is the reason why that fee proposed to go from 45 to 75. In addition, we are looking particularly for planning board, although it's not mentioned here, but it may be an ordinance amendment, for planning board advertising fees, that the applicant be required to pick that cost up directly, and going to ask the ordinance committee to look at that when they look at other fees. Removal of earth materials, a renewal application, those come up every year, and they've tended to be pro forma when they're dealt with by the planning board. It's recommended that that be decreased from $200 to $100. A concealed firearms permit, original, from 15 to 20, and a renewal from 5 to 10. And those are the recommendations that I would encourage the council to approve effective 30 days from now.
I do see Captain Williams is here representing the police department. There are three. Aren't you still there?
Boss is here.
Oh, I'm sorry. It's the bright lights here. Excuse me. I also see the chief is here also. If we have any questions, certainly the chief, I'm sure, is prepared to answer them with respect to any increase in fees.
I get.
We have some questions. Counselor.
I think mine's more directed to the manager than to the chief. I was just wondering how many parades a town sponsored, how are you going to deal with a fee for that? Town sponsored parades?
They are not subject to the fee.
Okay.
We don't, but the town doesn't pay any building permit fees. The only fees we pay are sewer fees for regular sewer customers. We don't pay property taxes, and we don't pay for application fees to our own boards.
Do we have more than our two town parades a year?
Occasionally, there are seven altogether.
We involve in usually 7 to 10 either road races or some type of competitive race. It's not town sponsored a year.
It's more road races than parades. That
yeah,
really
and we seem to be getting more of a year. In fact.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. A question to the manager about the zoning board application fee. Do our public hearing legal notices required to be placed in the newspaper for zoning, for applicants that come before the Zoning Board of Appeals?
Yes, they have to go into a newspaper of general circulation, and we use the Portland paper rather than the Courier because there are a lot of people who are interested in zoning issues who live in the area and not just in Cape Elizabeth.
Right, no, and I have absolutely no problem with using the Portland paper. I'm wondering, though, if the who pays for the legal notice? Is it out of the $75 fee?
That was the issue that I was raising that needs to be looked at by ordinance as well, and particularly with planning and zoning, and as well as with the Board of Sewer Appeals.
Okay.
And that's that perhaps you might want to look at an ordinance change as well, whereby the applicant would pay for it. But you know, we're really losing our shirts, if you pardon the expression, on zoning board activities. And you know, there was an example here earlier tonight of you know, an issue going to the zoning board that we've probably already spent $300 on in legal fees, and one that will certainly cost a lot more. And you know, about half the issues now before the zoning board do require some involvement by the town attorney, and you know, that's at an hour for $120. You know, the average case is costing us $60 just for attorney's fees before we look at legal, before we look at the ad plus the very expensive mailing cost with the notice requirements that we have, particularly in settled neighborhoods.
I wholeheartedly agree, and I didn't hear you say, looking at the applicant paying the legal notices for zoning board, but I heard it for planning board. I would be in favor of having the applicant pay those. I know a typical legal ad usually costs a minimum of $200. And I don't think the town needs to be absorbing that if somebody comes forward requesting a zone change or something before the zoning board that needs a legal notice in the newspaper. I don't think that the town needs to absorb that cost.
I found that all municipal planners strongly agree with that position.
Are there other questions?
I'm afraid I do have another one. Sorry. And reducing the removal of earth materials fee, since we're trying to increase our revenues and our fees, why can we really justify that?
I think it's similar to looking at the budget. Even though a lot of cuts were made, it didn't stop the council from looking at a few new programs and looking at changing things that weren't being done right. In this particular instance, it isn't a whole lot of money, but for a 5-minute session at the planning board level and maybe a half hour of the planner's time, it really didn't seem appropriate to be charging the $200 for the renewal applications.
For renewal.
For renewals, it is an annual permit.
Chief Pickering or Mr. Manager, I have a question about when is a road race a road race? It might sound odd, but there are certainly very publicly sponsored road races that utilize Cape Elizabeth. I mean, they begin in South Portland. There's a half marathon run every year sponsored by the Maine Track Club that runs all through the town and out of the town again. And then there are other more, how should I say, local, small-time, dead-end street type road races involving usually 10 to 15 citizens on a given day during the year. These road races don't enter out into any of the major arterial areas of Cape Elizabeth. Would we be considering both of these kind of road races requiring a $25 fee come 30 days from tonight?
Generally, the criteria we use to determine that is sponsorship. If it is a local or national or state-sponsored event, competitive races, etc., it would fall under this. Local events that just utilize, a small section of the street, we would not. So generally, it involves, unfortunately, Shore Road a lot of times, which we've had to deny recently because it's just been a real public safety issue. We encourage people to use 77 in the bikeway and other facilities we have of that nature. So I guess sponsorship, to answer your question, would be what we'd look to determine if it would fall under this fee structure.
It goes one step beyond that, though, I think, as well, and that's that any that requires any level of municipal services, if they want us to bring barricades out or they want us to do whatever. The road race that, people go ahead and just go have, with five people in the neighborhood, they're not going to require any municipal services, not going to be sponsorship, and they're never going to call us to know that this is, we won't even ever know that the race is going on. But if they require municipal service or is going to be advertising, they would have to get the permit.
Thank you very much. That's helpful. Councilor George.
Yes, one question to the chief. How do you handle one that originates in South Portland and comes out through Cape Elizabeth, even though maybe it was sponsored by South Portland, comes out through the Cape?
We require a
permit. You require a permit
for that, yes.
Okay.
Other questions for either the our manager or Chief Pickering? Hearing none, I would take a motion on the item.
Well, I take it.
Mr. Chairman, I would move that the fees as proposed by the manager be approved, and in addition to that we refer to the ordinance committee consideration of increased dog impoundment fees, alarm system fees, and other fees that may only be changed by ordinance.
Second.
I have a motion and a second. Further discussion? All those in favor? 7-0, unanimous vote.
Clarification, that was for 30 days from now?
That's correct.
Yes, sir.
Effective in 30 days. That gives an opportunity for people to be informed. Item 21, to consider a proposed amendment to the sign ordinance regarding construction signs and take any necessary action. I am going to refer this to our town manager.
Yes, Ernie McMain brought to my attention a week or so ago, the code enforcement officer, that all these construction signs that someone puts out in front of their houses for a contract when work is going on, that the new sign ordinance doesn't allow those. He spoke to a couple contractors about it, and there was a very upset reaction, as one might expect. There's a couple issues of concern. One is that if the police like to know who's doing the work, if they see suspicious vehicles, it's nice to have the sign there. Secondly, it's also so people aren't running all around the neighborhood looking for where is someone building a new house. So what I'm proposing is that you amend, is after review by the ordinance committee, you amend the sign ordinance to provide that one temporary construction sign attached to freestanding not to exceed 6 square feet per exposed face may be erected at any construction site for which there is an approved building permit. I think when the ordinance committee looks at this, one issue that they should give quite a bit of attention to is that phrase about an approved building permit, because when I wrote this, I was forgetting that painting of houses, which is something sometimes you don't have a permit for, but people like to have signs out that we probably don't want to prohibit that. So I would recommend this whole issue be referred to the ordinance committee.
Gee, I've got something to do.
Yeah.
any discussion on this proposal? I would take a motion then.
Before you take the motion, the discussion we had earlier about all other signs that weren't included on the chart would not cover these signs.
I don't think you'd want to include these signs in that discussion. I think we want to limit the size of them, which would not be done by what we had previously done this evening.
I thought there was a limitation.
It's larger than this.
This would be more restrictive.
Okay. Mr. Chairman, just to clarify from the manager that he might not be at the ordinance committee, this, you're thinking of painting, if somebody was painting, if somebody was putting siding on, if somebody was doing a roof job, any of that type work,
yes,
there'd be a sign for it.
Yeah, what you might do is just, you know, get rid of that clause at the end for which there is an approved building permit, change construction site to a more open language that indicates, you know,
that lets anybody in.
Home improvement activity, something like that.
Now, there's this, I'm thinking of the sign ordinance, and when this was brought to my attention as I read it in the packet, what about construction work on roads and whatever?
Those,
well, I don't think we dealt with that too much.
No, those are permitted traffic. Those are traffic safety signs, and those are permitted.
Okay, thank you. I think we've got to look at that.
Yeah. The traffic safety is baffling me momentarily.
Councilor Pearson.
I was just going to say one comment, and I don't know if this would be after a motion or whatever, but if this is made into a motion to be sent to the ordinance committee, that they also consider time restriction after the activity is ceased as far as how long that sign can stay at the given site. Because I know I've heard that from certain people. A sign has remained for quite some time after the activity, and it's caused them a little error to say, are they operating business from that place? Mm-hmm. So that's just something that if it does go to a committee, you'll want to look at. Thank you.
Mm-hmm. Well, I'm continuing to entertain a motion on this issue.
I was going to say, Chairman, Mr. Chairman, with that in mind, I move that we send the proposal as proposed by the town manager to the ordinance committee.
Second.
Further discussion? All those in favor? Thank you very much. A 7-0 vote. Item number 22 is to consider authorizing certain year-end transfers and take any necessary action. I will again ask the town manager to discuss this item.
Every first meeting in June, I come to the council with hat in hand, ask you to transfer certain balances to accounts that are in need of additional funds. I'll go over these briefly from top to bottom in this case. After the fiscal year began, the town purchased 1226 Shore Road. Between when we purchased it and the end of the year, we will have spent $1,300 on heating and other in new locks and other miscellaneous repairs. So it asks for a transfer of $1,300 into that account. General assistance, as many of you have probably read at the state level, is growing tremendously. This is local welfare. The original budget for that was about $15,000. It's proposed, and even this is going to be tight, to raise that to $25,500. Just today, the General Assistance Administrator, Barbara Ray, I think saw four or five clients. So probably spoke to a couple others on the phone. So it has been a very busy activity in Cape Elizabeth. CMP, in the midst of the winter and again this spring, increased their street lighting rates. They're now running at a monthly cost of $5,400. So we need an additional $5,000 to make a total streetlight budget of $62,000. The retirement cost in the budget was simply a case of inaccurate cost forecasting when the budget was done a year ago, February. We were $8,000 short. Primarily, we had anticipated two more employees to withdraw from the retirement system than did. There's still some hope that one or two may withdraw, but a couple did stay in that we thought might withdraw. When the budget was put together last year for elections, there was no amount budgeted for the printing of ballots for the special referendum election increasing the size of the school board. That cost was over $1,000, but through savings Deborah was able to achieve otherwise in the account. The additional amount needed is $400. Finally, as a very detailed and excellent memo from the Chief of Police indicates, the police budget is going to be about $11,000 short. That is primarily due to two police officers being out for an extended period. One of our officers has been out on workers' comp with both hands operated on in a workers' comp issue for carpal tunnel syndrome. And another police officer broke his ribs playing softball some time ago, keeping athletically fit. And I saw him over the weekend, and he tells me he's coming back on Thursday, which is certainly good news. And we also have another police officer out currently on bereavement leave due to the very unfortunate death of his spouse this past week. So, Chief, I did ask, because it is such a significant amount of money, Chief Pickering to be here tonight, and in case you should have any questions, but I would encourage you to approve all of these transfers. I should mention, I did at the beginning, that in the end the budget will be in the black with these transfers. We have been able to achieve savings in other accounts, and revenues are looking a little bit better. Thank you, Mr. Chairman.
Thank you, Mr. Manager.
I do have a question. Further down on your memo, it says the entire amount requested for adjustments is $36,200.
Yeah.
And that this amount will be saved in the public works account due to the light winter.
Yes. And?
And in the debt service account.
Yes.
And in the proposal for the public works garage, you also were using some of this leftover money from the light winter. So.
I have not used it twice, I can assure you.
But there's more there to use if you need it.
Now we've just about run out of it.
Okay, I just wanted to make sure we weren't either using it twice or there was more there than we realized.
We have not used it twice.
Okay. And the debt service account, how much was left in that? If you break that $36,000 down, how does it break down?
The amount projected to be in the public works budget is $27,000. However, the cost back in the garage, we have already charged to that account as the year went on. And when we did that projection of $27,000, left in that account, it reflected the fact that those costs were already charged to public works. So here it's $27,000 from public works and $9,000 roughly from the debt service account. That's in the tax anticipation note error.
Thank you.
We also got our bill today for our insurance programs for next year, and that shows we're going to have a surplus of about $8,000 there. So things, the news of late has been a little bit better than it was a few months ago.
Okay. Thank you.
Mr. Chairman, I'll make a motion that we authorize a manager to make these year-end transfers as he explained them in the memo.
Second that.
Further discussion? All those in favor? Unanimous 7-0 vote. Thank you. Item number 23, to consider authorizing certain balances to be carried forward into the next fiscal year and take any necessary action. I will again defer to our town manager.
This is, again, something that is asked every June. The charter provides that any project automatically carries over. However, I try to give the council as much information so you know what is being carried forward. The Arts Commission item, you seem to be starting at the bottom, is, as explained in the memo from the new chairwoman of the Arts Commission. Public Works Garage, you're aware of. 1226 Shore Road is the amount of the bond. The Cape Elizabeth Past to Present book, you funded at $17,000. I believe the amount was the balance is $16,330. That is due to be published within a month or so. The War Veterans Fund, after all the festivities, has $805 left in it. The WET Team, $5,481. Refuse disposal equipment, we just did expend about $1,000 for some work there because the DEP is now requiring us to have an operating permit. And we had to do some work with a collector system for drainage and water underneath it, so a holding tank. So that amount has been depleted, as well as the recycling committee is aware of this money, and they're giving strong consideration to increasing recycling next year with some of these funds, and they will be approaching the council before any of that is funded. The Gladys Brown Fund is for tree planting throughout the town. The Poor Farm Rental Account will have a balance of $14,030 at the end of the year. The library charges a dime for copies, and it adds up. It's added up to $10,700. So they should be able to buy a new photocopier without approaching the budget process at some point. Library gifts, I'm not sure the exact balance. George is spending money at this time on gifts. It might be a good opportunity to mention that the trustees of the library, working with the Friends of the Library, just raised $1,100 through a used book sale with a lot of books that were donated by citizens of the community, and that is going into the gift fund. The Land Acquisition Fund has a balance. I was supposed to add up these numbers and I didn't. Councillor McLaughlin tells me it should be $103,055. And I'll take her word for that. Street openings, those have to be used for repair of roads by state statute 3374. The Goddard Mansion Stabilization Account, $11,216. Fort Williams Improvements, $30,000. That's for the work the National Guard will be doing this summer. Southern Coastal Family Planning is an interesting issue. They are no longer in existence. They've merged with Planned Parenthood of Northern New England, and fairly, you know, somewhat controversial. And I didn't feel it was appropriate to send the money to a new agency without council authorization. And as of this date, they haven't requested funds. But rather than have them lose this year's funds because of apparently the confusion in the merger. I've proposed that that money be held until you could release it. And the town council dues and memberships account, $1,800, and that was the allocation for the membership in the NLC steering committee. I would like to add one to this, which would be 720-0136. When I was coming out of the IGA yesterday afternoon, I ran into Natalie Libby. Natalie is, for those of you that might not know her, is the longtime town clerk of the town of Cape Elizabeth, retired several years ago. She is also actively involved with the Sprague Hall renovation that's been ongoing. And she reminded me that several years ago, the Spragues gave $500 to the town for the benefit of the Sprague Hall for the painting of it, and that it was never spent. Well, unfortunately, that money lapsed into surplus at some point, while it should have been placed in a dedicated fund. So I told Nat that what I would try to do is have you add this evening to the carry forward balances, which would be in essence reappropriating it, so that I could then provide it to the Sprague Hall, Grange Hall, for their to the trustees for their continuing work there. But it was given to us, and it should have been set aside early. So those are my recommendations for carry forward balances, as well as I think I skipped over the road project account, which, you know, because of a lot of ongoing work, I'm not sure what the exact budget will be, but I'll let you know in July.
Any need for further clarification on this item?
Mr. Chairman, I have one comment. The Goddard Mansion, there's 11 grand there. Is there anything in the works as far as spending that money there, or is that just sitting there for somebody to come up with a bright idea of putting a part of a roof on one corner of it or something?
No, I go to it occasionally. I can't say I haven't been up there in the last few months, but I was up there 3 or 4 months ago, and you know, we look at it, we watch it, and you know, the thinking is that if, you know, at some point something happens there, we need to go in to do some work to stabilize it. It is available for that purpose.
So how many years has it been sitting there with 11 grand?
I don't think we have spent any funds at the mansion in 3 years.
Since Councilor Carson retired.
We had quite a major project after Councilor Carson left, actually. That was when a lot of the lintel work was done, some other improvements. So,
if she's watching tonight, she'll be here shortly. I'm after those funds, Penny.
I'm protecting them, Penny.
Other clarifications?
It's just on the land acquisition fund. I agree with Councilor McLaughlin's figure. It's $103,000.
So corrected? Seeing no other need for clarification, I would entertain a motion.
Mr. Chairman, I'll move that we authorize the manager to carry forward these balances as stated in the memo.
Second that.
Discussion?
Clarification. Did that exclude Sprague Hall?
I wrote it. Well, I'll include Sprague Hall, so it'll go out over the air. And I wrote down Sprague Hall and added it here.
Councilor Chappell, did your second include Sprague Hall?
Certainly did.
Thank you. We have a motion on the table, a second. All those in favor? Unanimous. Item 24 is to consider approving the town manager's reappointment of Richard C. Churchill, Jr. as the tree warden and take any necessary action. Mr. Manager.
I do this extremely enthusiastically. I don't know anyone that works as harder or is more dedicated than Rick. For such a small amount of money that he makes doing this. Just within the last week, I attended a tree planting ceremony in honor of Roy Maddox, our former tree warden. I attended a meeting of the Fort Williams Advisory Commission that Rick was at, going over several issues as well. We just received a contribution from Mrs. Lawrence Ralston, Joan Ralston, of some funds for some planting at the fort, and Rick was down there Saturday morning trying to assist with those plantings, so I highly recommend that you approve his reappointment.
Mr. Chairman, I move that we approve the reappointment of Richard Churchill, Jr. as tree warden.
Second.
Any discussion? All those in
I have a question before we vote. just because I've noticed this around my own home on the oak trees, the gypsy caterpillar, gypsy moth caterpillars, and if the manager would ask Mr. Churchill if there's any problem with those insects, whatever they are, at the fort. I mean, if we're going to get those on the oaks at Fort Williams, I'd like to know that we can be aware of it as soon as possible if it's happening and take any action that's possible. Thank you.
Any other discussion? All those in favor? Again, a unanimous reappointment for Mr. Churchill, who is doing an excellent job, I might add. Item 25, to consider approving a new lease for the daycare center at Fort Williams Park and take any necessary action. Again, I will ask our town manager to bring us up to speed on the daycare lease.
Yes, this particular lease is with a woman named Jillian Slagle, who has worked there for a couple of years and operated the daycare center this past year. Been very good to work with, and the proposed lease does provide for a 5% increase in the lease amount for the current year. So I would recommend that you authorize me to sign this lease. I would like to mention and remind the council, while I have a chance, that the Girl Scouts are due to move out in August, and I have been having some discussions with a Portland Human Service agency regarding moving out to the Girl Scout building. Their board has approved a move, to the fort. We have not yet really sat down for negotiations of rent amount, but it does look in this very difficult market, we will be able to have a new tenant. So that's certainly good news.
Any discussion on this particular lease?
Mr. Chairman, Mr. Manager, is this substantially the same lease as before except for the 5%?
That and just updating the dates of the term per year and when they have to notify us of if they wish to renew.
Councilor McLaughlin.
Thank you, Mr. Chairman. Mr. McGovern, have there been any problems experienced by the town with the current lessee?
None at all.
Thank you.
I would entertain a motion.
Chairman, I move that we approve the signing of the new lease for daycare center at Fort Williams Park.
Second.
Further discussion? Councilor Jordan.
Would you care to have in your motion that you authorize a manager to sign the lease?
Yes.
That would be appropriate.
I think it would be appropriate.
All right, fine.
The second would so include the signature. Thank you. We have a motion on the table. Any further clarification or discussion? All those in favor? Again, unanimous vote, 7-0. Item 26 is to consider scheduling a town council workshop to prepare goals for the upcoming year and take any necessary action. I would request that we indefinitely table this motion. We can take care of this after the cameras are off, since I'm not sure it's helpful to let all us citizens know when someone might be on a vacation, just for security purposes.
Very good idea.
Could I have a motion there, please?
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? I would also like to take an item that was not on the agenda. I would like to place an item on the agenda, thus we would need to suspend the rules to do this.
So moved.
Second.
All those in favor? I'd like to add item 27. I will entitle it the request for a time extension regarding the final report of the School Space Study Committee. Has everyone had an opportunity to review the letter from the chairman of the School Space Study Committee, Mr. Jeffrey White? There is basically, in summary, Mr. White has sent a letter to both the chairman of the council and the chairman of the school board, sending a letter on behalf of the Cape Elizabeth School Space Study Committee The purpose of the letter was to request an extension of the time by which the committee's final report is due. That would change from July 1st, 1991 to October 15th, 1991. And essentially, the request is made to permit sufficient time for the retention of architectural engineering consultants to review the middle school and Pond Cove Elementary buildings and thus report to the committee on their findings and recommendations. Any discussion on this particular item? Please, Councilor Pearson, one of our members of the School Space Study Committee representing the Town Council.
I was going to say, in that capacity, I just want to echo Jeff's concerns and also the committee's that the reason for the shift in the deadline is since the school board was gracious enough to make the funds available for the study, and we are well into the throes of interviewing said firms, and we're also placed stringent deadlines on the firms or made it known to them that we want the results of their studies ASAP, and they seem very receptive to do same. And I think that this particular study will be very beneficial to the total final report of the committee. So I recommend that this request be granted.
Perhaps. Is that in the form of a motion?
That's a motion. How's
Thank
that?
Thank you. I'll second it.
Further discussion? All those in favor? It's unanimous, 7-0. At this point, I would call for any citizen discussion of items not on the agenda. Hearing none, I will close that portion of the meeting. I would note before adjournment that we will be deciding on a workshop upcoming to prepare our goals for the upcoming year, and also to let the citizens know that following the adjournment of the Town Council meeting, the Town Council will meet in our capacity as the Board of Directors of the museum at Portland Headlight. There is not a particular need to televise this portion, thus we will end the meeting only after giving one note of thanks, and I neglected to mention this at the beginning of the meeting. I think this would be a good opportunity to thank Jim Murray publicly for the extraordinary effort that he put forth in terms of the parade this year and the whole Memorial Day festivities. It proceeded very, very smoothly, and again, it is a credit to his organizational skills that he lends to the town each year in this regard, and we thank him very much. Having said that, I will officially adjourn this meeting.
Oh, you don't want a motion?
Motion.
Oh, I'm sorry. I will take a motion for adjournment.
So moved.
Jump the gun. All those in favor? And I will again officially adjourn this meeting.
The Portland Headlight meetings are going to be in the cafeteria because, one, it's cooler, and two, the materials that are involved in one of the issues are down there, if you can see.
Frank has got the gavel back.
'Vast areas of land near the Earth's polar regions. Glaciers of this type build up at the center of the slope outward toward the sea in all directions. Antarctica and Greenland have continental glaciers. Valley glaciers are long, narrow bodies of ice that fill high mountains, valleys. They move down sloping valleys from bowl-shaped hollows located among the peaks. The biggest valley glacier is the Lambert Valley Glacier. It is 40 miles wide and more than 250 miles long. Sign of a valley glacier after it is gone. When you look at a valley and you see that it is shaped like a U. It has hanging valleys and waterfalls coming into it. It has sheep-shaped rocks, potholes, and lakes scattered along its bed. Then you can be sure a glacier was there. The glacier flows down slope because of the pull of gravity. The surface of a glacier is stiff and rigid, unlike the mass of ice below. It often fractures and forms deep cracks called crevices as the glacier flows over uneven. For a valley glacier, the climate must be cold, and a lot of snow of one winter does not have a chance to melt before the next winter's snow covers it. 10% of the Earth is covered by glaciers. 75% of the world's fresh water was once a glacier. People who study glaciers are called glaciologists.
And that's the end of our project.
My name is Jason McLean, and I did a project on acid rain. And first, this is sulfur, sources of sulfur dioxide emissions in the USA, and 4% of it comes from transportation, 1% comes from residential heating, and 15% comes from industrial, and 68% comes from electricity generation, and 12% of it comes from other. And then there's sources of nitrogen oxide emissions in the USA, 45% of it comes from transportation, 2% comes from residential heating, 17% from other, electricity generation 33%, and 3% comes from industrial. And the two mix and they get into the moisture of the air, and then it rains and the acid rain gets into ponds, and at a high level of acid the fish will die, and then it gets in, if it gets to the trees, it'll kill the trees, and it wrecks soil. And here's some things I tested. Rainwater collected 527, it was a 5.0. And then Little Pond collected 528, it was a 7.6. And Great Pond was collected at 528, it was a 6.4. Tap water collected 528, 7.6. Nesty Warren collected 6.1, it was a 6.2. And this is a picture of the United States and the pH levels. Blue stands for 4.7 to 5.0. Purple stands for 4.6. Red stands for 4.4. And green stands for 4.2. And Maine is one of the worst places that has acid rain, and New England is the worst because they have factories all along here, and we get the smoke, and it comes down here, and Canada comes down here, and we get all of it. And this is a pH scale that tests it, and a 7.0 is neutral. And the darker the blue, the higher alkalinity or a base, and the darker yellow is the low acid level. And then here I have some pictures. I went into Portland, and this is a picture of a tree dying. And this is the Portland High School, which is eroding because of the acid rain. And this is the two smokestacks that we have.
This is Casey.
I went into Portland and took some pictures, and this is a tree that is dying. This is Portland High School, which is right here is starting to be eroded. And this is the two smokestacks we have, which is SD Warren we have in Maine. And this is a picture of a statue that is turning blue because it has copper. When a lot of acid rain gets on it, it'll turn blue. And this is these two places where it's starting to crack and break away. And I have an experiment right here, which is copper. And after a while, it will turn blue because of the acid level, just like it did right here. And then the way I tested my samples is I took up to that line, and I used indicator solution, and I just put 3 drips in, and I put cap on and shake, and then it was a greenish color, and I matched it up with that, and it was 6.2. And then I have an experiment here with, this is a baking soda, which on here is a 8.2 would be a base, and then I have vinegar, which is an acid, is 3.3. And if you mix the two, then this is what will happen. Starts to bubble up, and then bubbles up, and then what it does is it neutralizes the thing. And then this is another experiment I did with lemon juice, and I tested it with this, and this is going to show which up here is a 2.2. I'm going to test it, and then it'll come out an orange color. Then I match it up with this, and it's a pH 2. And then what I did with my other experiment is I tested it, this that I had already mixed with baking soda and vinegar, and I got a very light color. Then I put my hand in baking soda and did this. And then in a while it turned green. And then I tested, this is ammonia. And I took a piece of litmus paper. And I tested it. And it turned dark, dark blue. Because up here, ammonia is a 13. And then this is the piece that turned green after I put my finger in baking soda. And that's the end of my project.
Okay. Hello,
my name is Mike Kempton, and I'm Vincent Olson. And we're doing a project on rockets. This is a rocket launching stand. It is used to launch off rockets, and the rod right here stabilizes it when it goes up. The blast deflector right here on the rocket is used to deflect the blast of the engine from the ground or the stand so it won't catch anything on fire. Here is a motor that we cut open, and this shows the stages. At first, there's a clay nozzle here for the fire to go up. This is acceleration for the rocket to have traveling thrust when it goes up. The green here is tracking smoke, so you can see where the rocket is. The ejection charge is the yellow right here. It explodes and sends the parachute or recovery device flying out. There are six different ways of recovery.
The six ways of recovery are, one is featherweight. It is, an example is this rocket right here. The ejection charge will push up the motor and featherweight just lets it fly down. And there's two is a free fall. It's just a heavy featherweight that falls real fast. And then three is ribbon recovery, which is, see Mike,
when the ejection charge hits,
and it's just a ribbon that pulls it down. And four is parachute recovery, which I have a parachute in here, and this brings it down. And then number five is helicopter recovery, which we don't have a rocket to explain that, but it is.
But when a helicopter is down, it goes like this.
It like helicopters down. And then there's glide recovery, and with that there is a glider that will glide down. And then, and that's it. Actually, the glide recovery was number six. And then here are the parts of a rocket right here. There is a nose cone, there is a body tube, launch lug, wings, and an engine mount. And then there's a little thing here on igniters, which we will show you a demonstration. Igniters are used to ignite the rocket when it is ignite the rocket engine when it's ready to launch. And right here is an igniter, and we have two other demonstrations. This was going to be a stationary rocket launch, but it's too wet outside to do it. And that was going to be a stationary rocket motor to show you. But the only demonstration we can do right now is a rocket igniter.
Okay. Since you get the cord, I'll push the button. Here is an rocket controller. The rocket controller works. You put the safety key in, so nobody can launch it with that. That means it's armed, and you can ignite it. And here's the launch button. Here's the igniter. And that would ignite the rocket motor. This is a small rocket motor. That's what it would ignite. You would stick. I better disarm this. You would stick the igniter in here, fold it over, put a piece of tape in it, and me and Mike would just put a little piece of tissue paper in there to make the burning a little better. And then you stick it on the bottom of the rocket, and I have a rocket right here. You put it on the thing. You hook up the caps. You go far away, and you launch it. And that is the end of our project.
No,
well,
and also this is called wadding. It is used to you put it in and you use it to protect the parachute or recovery device from the engine's hot ejection gases, so it won't get stuck in and the nose cone won't come out. And
here's our that's about it. And here's a motor that's cut open, and that's the end of our project.
Yep.
All right.
Thank you.